Hi, my name is Antonis, and I am the painter of this video. Today, you need no introductions for the study I'm about to do. It's the famous Mona Lisa, of course. And I decided to do a study on and try the technique of Leonardo da Vinci, the technique of Sfumato that he extensively used in this amazing, of course, portrait of Mona Lisa. So I believe, of course, I wasn't there when Leonardo da Vinci painted this amazing portrait. I wasn't there, but I believe that Leonardo da Vinci must have used a very similar approach to this one. Of course, let me know if you have any other idea. I'm pretty sure he used Verdaccio, and he painted just like iconography, the darker elements of his painting on top of that Verdaccio. So I will follow that same process, trying to explore a little bit this painting, see if my notion, my suspicion about his technique actually leads to something similar. Of course, I haven't seen Mona Lisa from up close. Even if I went to the Louvre, it's so busy, the room of Mona Lisa. Hundreds of people try to simultaneously get close to the portrait. But I will follow a high resolution print, and I will try to do my best on this study. So as you see, I took a very small board. My board here is not very large, and I will just focus on the face of Mona Lisa and try to see if something nice comes out of this study. Even if my goal here is not to really do an exact copy of Leonardo da Vinci, my goal here is to just really get familiarized myself more with oil as a medium, and get better in the blending of this medium, probably exploring the sfumato technique as much as I can. So what I do here, I have painted with egg tempera this board. This light green color that I use as a base is painted with egg tempera. And for this color, I've used a little black, some yellow ochre, and a little bit of green, and some cadmium yellow. I also have added, if I remember well, a little titanium white. So it doesn't really matter the exact shade of the exact hue of this greenish color. On top of that egg tempera base, I have transferred my drawing from paper. I've used a transferring paper that I made myself. It's not a commercial transferring paper. And after transferring this, my drawing of the face of Mona Lisa, as you see now, I'm doing some very basic shadowing on the face of Mona Lisa with oil. We can use oil on top of tempera. We can't use the opposite. We cannot use tempera or acrylics on top of oil. So I just try to watch very closely my reference here and see which areas are darker than my Verdaccio, my base color here, And I will try to just paint these shadowier parts with oil. My board here was very absorbing of the oil, as you can see probably. So after just right after I finished with this process of establishing my facial characteristics here, I had to actually varnish the board with a varnish appropriate for oil colors, and this made the painting, the board, lose its absorbency and allowed me to paint on top of the painting without any dramatic change, shift of the colors. I do hope I make sense so far. And let me grab this chance and say thank you for being here, for following me in this channel and on this tutorial. It's really nice, and your comments below are always amazing. So really thank you so much, and keep watching and let's see what will happen here. So at this point, as you see, I'm not in a hurry. I really take my time establishing these shapes of shadows on top of Mona Lisa. And it's important to not go away from the drawing that you have transferred, to keep the characteristics intact, in place. Try to not erase and move the eyes or the irises of the eyes, and then try to blend as much as possible. I suspect that as I say, I'm pretty sure that Da Vinci used the Verdaccio, and then he painted, like me here, the shadows on top of that Verdaccio. I'm not sure that he used exactly the same texture of the color. I believed he worked with thinner colors at this point. But since my board was so absorbent, as you see, it was hard for me to work with thinner oil colors. So here I'm using a brush. So far I've used brushes that are appropriate, are bought for oil painting use. And as I'm painting, since I haven't done this ever before, I try to understand, I try to feel my brushes and to understand how I will proceed with this study, what kind of brush is better to use later on. And I've decided now that I'm ready to move into my first light of this painting, of this study, to use a brush that is softer. I believe that Da Vinci must have used thin layers of color to paint his paintings. So I will use a softer brush appropriate for watercolors or egg tempera. And in order to make a good use of this brush while I'm using oils, I will have to thin down the colors a lot to make them much liquid, but at the same time with some substance on them. So here I'm using a color that consists from titanium white, a little bit of yellow ochre, and just a tiny little bit of carmine red. It's an orangey red, just a little bit. You can also, I also have added some drops of a color similar to my Verdatio, just to make it a little bit more brownish. And with this brush, that doesn't really have to be a new brush. As you see, the brush is a little bit used, and its bristle opens a little bit. I will try to establish the basic shapes of light as I see them on my reference. So Da Vinci is not that far chronologically and in the history of art from all those masters like Giotto, Simone Martini, that used this technique to build their faces, the forms. And I suspect that he mustn't have approached his painting differently. Of course, I'm not an expert, and I'm not interested in say finding the exact technique of Da Vinci. It just seems to me that this probably will lead to a result that's going to be pretty close to the original. And I have to say that oil is not my field of expertise, I would say. I work, my experience is more on egg tempera in general. I used to paint a lot with oil as I was a student back in the early 2000s. And late 90s, but then I gradually moved to tempera and egg tempera. Although it's a medium that it's fascinating to me, it's exciting to me, the potential of this medium, and I really approach it with a lot of respect and caution. Now, as you see here, it doesn't really matter to me that my brush is a little bit open, because my intention is, at the end, to make a face that is blurry a little bit. Sfumato, the technique of sfumato that Da Vinci has used is exactly that. He blends the colors with each other, and at the end he creates this foggy-like effect. Everything blurs into something, as if things are out of focus. So I will try to. The only way that I can imagine that I can make this effect, this result, is by having a brush stroke that is precise, of course, but at the same time, and on the edge of the shapes, this can be a little bit blurry. Now, this light that you see here has happened some days after I painted the Verdatio and the shadows. My shadows now are completely dry. On the top of these shadows and the facial characteristics, as I told you, I sprayed a varnish. I applied a varnish for oils. The varnish is dry as well. And now this yellow ochre color light that I'm applying is on top of a completely dry surface. And at this point, I have to say, I don't really care about the exact color of the face of Mona Lisa, the original color, because first, I haven't seen it from up close, never. And secondly, even if I saw that, I know that the color has changed throughout the centuries and the history. The varnish that Da Vinci has applied is glued, attached to the colors, and has tarnished them a little bit. So I can assume that he painted a very rosy and nice color, but at this point I'm more interested on this study in recreating this sfumato effect, this blurry effect on the face of Mona Lisa, and of course to try to recreate her gaze maybe as much as possible. It's very aspiring, but the pleasure of painting and following such a master is really great. When we paint, we mostly do it for our pleasure, and it's nice to try things that give us some joy. Now here, as you see, I use a Kolinsky brush. It sounds crazy to work with a Kolinsky brush using oils, but I felt pretty sure that the only brush that could help me here would be a soft brush, allowing me to work with soft, thin layers of color. Here, for the white of the eye, I use the same color of the first light, let's say, but I also added just a little bit of titanium white at this point, and a little bit of green. So, as you see, I'm still working on this, on building the lights on this verdaccio. I try not to worry about how horribly she looks at this point, and just try to establish these shapes. And at the same time, I imagine how she would look later on. Here, as in iconography, I will make the central areas of these light shapes, I will make them some stronger, and I think she looks, at this point my painting looks creepy. I hope Da Vinci will not stir in his tomb. Anyway. So now, as you see, I'm creating a color on my palette that is a color in value in between this first light that I've used and the color of the verdaccio in value. And this color has titanium white, it consists from titanium white, some cadmium yellow, a little bit of black, the same colors that I used for my verdaccio, but I also added a little bit of cadmium yellow and some yellow ochre, some black. It doesn't really matter again the exact hue of this color, I just want to create a color that fills in between these two colors, the verdaccio and the first light. Now with this color, as you see, I'm trying to do a very basic blending in between. I don't care if I cover these shapes of light that I painted just before. It doesn't really, I don't really care about that. I'm more interested into blending this color that I'm doing now to the verdatio than the first light. I don't care if I cover or my brush strokes on the light are abrupt. There is an abrupt blending. I'm more interested in blending this color to my verdatio. That's my main issue. I will work by blending always to the verdatio or to the darker areas. I think you will understand this later on better. It's nice that unlike the tempera pigments, the tempera colors on your palette, oils do not dry and you can let them be there as much as you can. The important, I would say, one of the tips in order to paint yourselves this study in your studio, one of the tips is to really, really always know what's on your palette. Do not lose track of what colors you create, because you will have to often go back and forth into lighter and darker colors in value, and it's going to be much easier if you keep remembering where is what. Things will get busy on your palette at some point, so it's always good to know what color you used when. Keep things as clear as you can on your palette, and you will do much, you will do great. So as you see here, I keep blending the, I keep painting, adding this in-between color, with mostly with me worrying about the part of this first in-between color to the proplasmos. I have to tell you that I will use almost four in-between colors, going from lighter blendings to darker and then back to light again. So what I said about the palette is really important. So here, again, doing this same blending. I would really be happy if you got inspiration and tried this study of Mona Lisa, and always happy to receive your studies, your paintings. My email is listed below in the description of this video, and I do hope you will get some inspiration to try this study following my video. If you do, please, please do send me your results on my email. Of course, you can use a canvas here, since we paint with oils, you can use a canvas. It's going to be much easier for you to acquire the supplies for such a study. Don't worry if you cover parts of the previous, of the darker areas, because we will go again darker. We will use darker colors again, as you will see later, and we will reestablish areas that are covered or seem covered now by color. This will also allow us to do some better blending and achieve this beautiful sfumato effect of Da Vinci. It looks a little bad so far, but now I will going to add my second blending color. That is a color that is even darker than my first blending color, a color that is closer to my verdaccio. My verdaccio, of course, now is almost completely covered by everything, but. You will observe your palette and see that now you will have to make a color that is a little darker than your first blending color, and with this color you want to a better blending on the shadower part. Try to blend the part of the first blending color to the verdaccio a little bit more. Now, I have to say one more tip. So far I'm painting on wet. I don't wait after I started painting the light on the face of Mona Lisa. I haven't waited for anything to dry. I keep painting in one session. So my first blending color and my first light, my first blending color, and now my second blending color is painted on top of wet paint. In order to avoid sweeping the color below, what I do every time I add, let's say, a layer of painting, like here, on my palette, I will add just a little bit more oil, linseed oil, on my color, just a few drops. I want gradually my color to get more oily. So this, the consistency of this second blending color that is darker and closer to my verdaccio will be a little bit more fatty, a little bit more oily, just a little bit. I will make sure that I will add a few drops of oil, whereas on my previous my first blending color, I would have, say, just one drop of oil on my palette. And this will help me apply color better. Of course, my color is thin in consistency, is not very thick, as you see here, and but is just a little bit more oily. And as you see, I darken the areas that before we are disappeared. The eyes of Mona Lisa are, of course, magical. The way Da Vinci has painted are really, truly unbelievable. I will just try to darken according, of course, to my reference. Here on the video, my camera did a great job. It's very zoomed in. In reality, it seems a little bit smoother, a little bit more, a little bit closer to what I want to achieve. So I was so into this study that I haven't asked you how are you. Please let me know if you are okay, if you are creative, and I just want to say hi a little bit more and communicate with you as much as I can. This will be the first part of this study. I will end the video at the point where I have complete this process of blending the first light to my verdaccio. It's gonna be, in reality, it took me some hours, and I want to split the video into two parts. The second part will be the part of lighting my first light, going even lighter, and maybe add some rosiness to the yellow face of Mona Lisa. Now, this second blending color, as you see, is darker, of course, but also just a tiny little bit brownier than my first blending color. And as you see, I paint just very, very barely touching the surface of the board. It's you have to be, if you decide to do this study, you have to be very delicate with your brush. Again, I'm still using a Kolinsky brush so far, with thin oily colors, and I'm barely touching the surface. Now, as you see, I'm adding a third blending color, as I call it. Labels do not really matter, but it's a darker color that will help me define even more the characteristics of this face. I don't think this would be possible if I used a harder brush. You have to be comfortable with your brush. You have to feel that you have to imagine where you want to reach, and try to understand and feel what kind of tool will help you, what kind of brush will help you achieve the result you want. Now, if I used a harder brush for oils, this result so far would be impossible. But with Kolinsky brush and using thinned colors, this seems easier. Let me know below in the comments what do you feel about this study, if you think that it was successful, if you have any other idea of how Da Vinci painted Mona Lisa. As I said, my goal is not to really unlock the way Da Vinci painted, but more to practice myself and see what I can learn by studying such an amazing face like this of Mona Lisa. Now, as you see, when I've painted this third blending color, I will start going backwards. Now, as you see, I'm using the same color as my second blending color, and with this color I will try to blend things even more. So this now is very important, what I'm gonna say for this study. As you saw, I went after I applied my light, I started gradually going darker and darker. At some point I reached my third dark, let's say, shade, and then I started going backwards in order to make an even finer blending. So now I will use my second blending color, then I will use again my first blending color to blend the second color I use now, and then I will use, after my first blending color, I will again use my first light. If I need, I can go back and forth many times like that, just to feel that I've done a good job with blending. And this is how I think Sfumato is made, by very fine layers of thin oil color, painted with very fine brush strokes. I can't really imagine that Da Vinci was coarse with brush stroke with painting, but it doesn't really matter again. I believe that or this is maybe a way that I feel organic to me, I feel relevant to me in order to build this face of Mona Lisa. Now, here you see this more clearly, using again the second blending color to blend the first blending color to the second one. Little by little, with very fine brush strokes. Don't worry about the lighter part, you will blend this later on. Just try to keep your shapes intact. Try to keep the shadowy parts, for example, around her eyes intact. Do not expand these shapes. Don't make them bigger. Don't make them smaller. Try to imagine how it will look later on while you are painting, and try to keep these shapes as much intact as possible. Now, your only preoccupation is to make an as fine blending as possible in these shadowy parts. Try though to keep that scale in your mind. For example, now that I'm doing this blending, I will not touch the deep dark colors with this color. I will try to paint in the appropriate areas. So now you see that I'm doing this blending by using a color that is in between the first light and the first blending. So this, of course, is not something, it's not a recipe. It's something that the study itself commands me to do. I see that I need a color to, I need some blending to be done between the first light and my first blending color. So I will create an in-between blending color now that is lighter than the first blending color I did. I'm laughing because it's all about blending colors and blending color this, blending color this. Okay, I know it's confusing, but it's like pretty serious study, and there's a lot of blending in this study. That's why I'm like this. But I do hope that even if you don't understand me, or if I am confusing to you, that the video will be self-explanatory. I always loved the non-existent eyebrows of Mona Lisa. I don't know, for some reason I found them very exciting. I don't know. I found them beautiful, actually. And intriguing. Why doesn't she have any eyebrows? Or why the eyebrows left the painting? I don't know. But you see here how I do this in-between blending. And I don't really care if at this point I will cover everything. Oh, not everything. I will cover all the lighter first light that I painted. I don't care if I cover it with this blending color, because I know that later on I will add a second light. I will that will bring the face into the result that I want. Try to do a good blending job here on the eyelids. It's very important. Try to keep this haziness that Da Vinci has given to his painting. And truly, this takes some time. I have to say though that it was very satisfying to me painting this study. I really had a good time in my studio. When I'm talking about good time, I mean the excitement of painting, and the excitement, of course, of painting something new, something unexpected, different. Of course, I mean, new in my painting history. Mona Lisa is not a new painting. I had a good time painting this. It completely absorbed me. And when I'm painting, I'm completely lost into this process. I forget what's happening out there. And it's nice. It's really satisfying and nice. So thank you so much for being so far with me at this study. If you haven't yet, please do subscribe to this channel. It's really helpful to me. It's really nice to see that people are interested in what I'm doing, and be part of this community, ask questions, answer other people's questions. Or mine. And anyway, thank you so much for your beautiful presence and your nice comments. So So here I have a very explicit area on my palette with this color that is in between the first light and my first blending color. I know where to dip my brush. This is important. And as I said before, I have added also just one or two more drops of oil medium because I'm painting on the still wet first light in order to keep my brush strokes tidy. I will have to make this layer a little bit more oily. As a rule, as a general rule in oil painting, we go from thinner layers of painting to fatter layers of painting, especially if we work a la prima, if we work wet on wet. And it's something that we should keep remembering. Don't start by very oily, fat layers. Well, actually, let's say this. Don't start by painting very oily layers. Your color can be thin, but very oily. So do not add a lot of oil medium on your palette from the beginning. At the beginning, just thin your colors down with turpentine, just plain turpentine and nothing else. And as you proceed and you paint, just gradually add some drops of oil medium. At the same time, start by painting thin layers of color and gradually make them thicker. So there are two things you have to remember in general when you paint with oils. We go from thinner layers with less fat layers of paint to more fatty layers of paint. And until we can't work anymore, we'll have to wait for some days for this to dry and then start from painting on a dry surface. And at the same time, you also have to remember working from thin, using thin layers to more thick. Impasto is something, a very thick, for example, layer that we will use at the final stages of our painting. So here I will do this layer, this blending of the first layer to my first blending color that I used before. Of course, you see that I'm covering almost everything of the first light. That's fine. I will lighten this face later on. Just make sure to make a great blending job on the edges of these shapes as much as you can. I do hope that I'm doing a nice job explaining my process. It's really, I would really like to see you trying something like that, not necessarily painting the face of Mona Lisa if you are not into something like that, but just understanding this process and maybe get some inspiration and work, maybe using another piece of art from the history of art, or maybe using a portrait of someone you love. It would be great, though, to see that, to feel that you learned something and this video was helpful to you. Again, here, I know what color I'm using. I know that the color I'm using now is a color slightly darker in value to my first light that I used, to the first layer of light that I used. And with this color, I will now I'm doing some more blending. Another thing that I want to say is that, okay, this face of Mona Lisa, we have seen it countless times. We are very familiar with this, and I have to say that it has some very slight, very light nuances. If you slightly change something on her mouth or the lighting on her cheeks, then the whole thing really collapses, because we are so familiar and everything has to be as much as closer to the reference as possible. As I say, if similarity happens, it's great. Also, the same thing when you paint a portrait of a friend of yours or a relative. Similarity to achieve this, it's something nice. But in my opinion, my goal here is more to learn out of this process than to make her identical. I'm pretty sure that even if Leonardo himself wanted to copy his Mona Lisa, it would be very, very difficult for him as well to make the exact same, to give her the exact same expression and the exact same smile, etc. It's something that it's humanly impossible. We are not photocopies. The intention here, I think, is to be first to have fun in the studio, to be something, to create something that you like. You will enjoy the process of doing such a study. Secondly, to familiarize, as I said, with the materials and see if what we learn from such a study can be applied somewhere else. I know that, for example, oil painting today is much different than in many cases, of course, it's much different than painting like Da Vinci. It's not something painting has changed throughout history. I will not say that has been improved, or this doesn't apply when we talk about the arts. But it's always, we have painters that do use this style, let's say, in order to paint something that will be very contemporary and very intriguing today. So I don't think that there is any knowledge lost or unnecessary. I think it's really nice to be able to paint like this and then choose to paint differently. This kind of painting will inform your more personal paintings, and it's always nice to see where these studies will lead you as a painter. For me, this period, the last 3 or 4 years, was a very transitional period for me, I have to say, and I had to reconsider my personal work, my work as an artist, and what kind of paintings I would like to paint. And I find a little console in this, in doing these studies, since I feel that I am in this transitional period. I feel that I am learning something out of doing this, and I'm pretty sure that this kind of painting will inform later on my personal artwork, my personal body of work as well. So I'm just waiting to see what's gonna be born, personally, I mean, in my artistic life. And in the meantime, I will be glad to learn something with using all these masters as my teachers. I'm not here, of course, to compare myself with Da Vinci. Da Vinci was an unbelievable personality. He was homo universalis, as we say. He didn't only paint, but his mind led him into beautiful, amazing ideas and inventions. I will be glad if I achieve a beautiful study for my beautiful study of Mona Lisa according to my skills. But little by little, this face comes to life. It has some little resemblance to the actual Mona Lisa, and the thing is, in painting, we don't only need here, for example, my intention was not to just achieve the resemblance, as I said, to Mona Lisa, but to also achieve some resemblance on the way the original Mona Lisa was painted. I'm not sure that I have truly achieved that. I would have to see a painting of Da Vinci from up close. He has the finest and more fine details I have seen, along with a couple more painters, of course. But his details, his brush stroke is so fine that it's out of my range to paint like that. But at least I would be happy if I approach even a little his technique of painting, or his I mean his process of painting. I would be happy if somebody told me, yes, this was his approach. He did the verdatio, he did the dark facial characteristics, then he did the light blending, and then the second light. This would be something that would feel great. But even if Da Vinci did not paint like this, of course, who can really say the process of Da Vinci, who was there in his studio while he painted? We just make assumptions. I believe if somebody knows more, please do say, do send me your resources, and please enlighten me. That could be really great. But as I say, even if Da Vinci did not paint like this, using these steps, I still feel great since I had a good time in my studio and I did familiarize myself more with this amazing medium that is the oil colors. Now here I'm doing the eyes, the white of the eyes. I try to observe my reference as much as I can. I want to see which areas of the part of the eyes is a little bit in the shadow and how bright the white part of the eyes is. Is it really that much brighter than the color of the skin? What is the comparison in between these two? Then how abrupt does the iris end? And in what shape does, in what shape, yes, the iris end and the white of the eyes begin? Try to do these questions, and after you establish a basic light for the eyes, etc., then proceed with doing some blending, maybe. Or try to compare, is the right side of the white of the eyes the same color as the left side? I see that here on the left eye, the right side of the white is darker. It's confusing, eh? With the left and the right, left and the right. I know it's confusing. Just try to observe the reference and you will be fine. Now, if I move myself a little further from the screen, now that I'm observing my painting, I really see that it looks nice. In general, the iris do not end very abrupt. The circle of the iris is not very abrupt to the eye of the eyes. There is some play there, and many skilled painters know this play, and they try to do a very basic blending in between the iris and the white of the eyes. So keep that in mind when you paint eyes in general, that there is a little bit of transition between irises and the white of the eyes. The same thing with our eyes. If you closely observe our eyes on the mirror, you will understand what I'm talking about. Here I see that this needs to be lighter a little bit more. I left the video here on its normal speed just to give you an understanding of how slowly I do these processes. It takes time and it takes some thought and effort. That's what makes our process so satisfying. If something goes very wrong, do not panic. try to keep your cool, try to find the funny aspect in that. Sometimes painters, we have accidents, and it is disappointing, I have to say, but if something, if an accident is a serious one and cannot really change, then we just have to accept it and proceed. Eyes are tricky, they have to be exactly here. I will try to paint them as closely to my reference as possible, otherwise the slightest change will result to a very different gaze than the one of the original. I would like to achieve that similar gaze of Mona Lisa. Sometimes while we paint with oils, things become very pasty, very thick, the color gets thicker and thicker. If we feel that we can't really continue painting like that, but we need to, we can wipe the color off with some spatula very lightly, or we could wipe the color with a piece of cloth. Otherwise, we can just let things dry for a couple of days and then proceed with painting again. So I just remember that you can join my amazing supporters, my amazing patrons on patreon.com. It's a site where you can support the material, the content that I upload here, and me financially. If you feel like that, if you are in a state where you can give to other people, I would appreciate your support for my content. And I have to say that I'm not a full-time artist. I aspire to be there. And having people supporting me, it's really, really amazing. I really thank all of my patrons there. If you feel that you can support this goal of mine, please do so. It's gonna be great. Anyway, again, you have a great presence here, and just your subscription to this channel, just your presence here, for me it's enough and really great. Again, if I half close now my eyes, this face looks nice. I hope, again, Da Vinci will not visit me in the night. Accusing me of defamation. I really sometimes wonder how these people painted their how they created their artworks, not only painting But any kind of artwork. It's to me unbelievable. I remember once I visited the Museum of Delphi in Greece. And in Delphi there is a very famous sculpture. It's called Iniochos. It's a green, you can Google that. It's a green sculpture of a young man. And before I visited Delphi, I Googled to see what to expect. And I saw online that sculpture and I was, okay, whatever. It looked boring and as something that I had seen before. When I actually entered the room of the sculpture of Iniochos, I was truly shocked. It was an experience that I'll never forget. The sculpture was as if was made by aliens, as if it was here from the future. The way this sculpture was made was truly fascinating, nothing like I had ever seen before. And to me it was, I just couldn't imagine how human hands created these works of art, how human hands were able, human minds were able to create such a non-earthly beauty. It was really, really unbelievable. The same thing with many works of art, Mona Lisa, of course, and other paintings of Da Vinci are in such a category. I don't know if Mona Lisa is overestimated. It's an amazing work of art anyways. It doesn't really matter what I think, but and I haven't seen it, as I said, from up close. Otherwise, I don't have the experience of this piece of art. But there are many others that truly give me this impression that they were not made from human hands, but they were in reality. And that makes me feel great about our race, about humanity. Here I'll do some more, I will add a little bit of darker shadows on the sides of her face. I will try to do this very cautiously, as you see here, and again with the same blending technique. I will do some, I will add some shadows. And I think little by little I'm ready to let this study rest for some days before I proceed with painting some more lights on her face. Very softly, barely touching, with a much oily now color here, since everything is wet underneath. What you see me painting now is oil medium with turpentine and very thin, barely some color in that. The areas of the cheeks there are very important for, in order to give this beautiful, beautiful smile of Mona Lisa. I will try later on when everything will be dry, or my next session after a couple of days, I will try to see if I can do some further blending on the whole face, try to see if I can eliminate these some little imperfections maybe that I need to do. And I will see how things will behave when things will be dry. Now here you see I add some final details. These details are darker, some darker elements as seen on the reference. Very fine lines that I wish I could do as great as Da Vinci. And I think little by little I come to the end of this first part of the video of how I did this study of Mona Lisa. It does not look bad, I would say. Let me know what you think of this study. And you can listen to my dog barking to some cats, probably. So, yes. Sometimes I feel so blessed to be a painter. I hope you do feel the same as well. It's really a blessing for us. As I often say to my videos, I would be deeply in trouble if I didn't spend time in my studio. So thank you so much for being here. I do hope you found this video interesting and useful to you. If you found this helpful, please do subscribe to this channel. More tutorials like this will follow. I want to thank you so much and stay healthy, stay creative, and I will see you soon with another tutorial. Bye.